think over the, some of the attributes of Allah can bring you back to that base, back to that original way of thinking, that Allah knows every word spoken in the heavens and on earth. He's the Al-Hakim, the wise. El-Alim, the all-knowing. As-Sami, the all-hearing. Now, if you just stop and reflect on that, our Creator has the ability to hear every word that's spoken in the heavens and the earth. So, all of those superheroes that they're forcing us on with these movies and TV shows, Allah just blows that out the window. You know, we're looking at Captain Marvel, Superman, The Flash, and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And so, we're starting to get a sense of superpowers. But Allah is saying, no. I'm the one that you should be in awe of. I'm the one that you should give respect to. These are my powers. So think about Allah's power. The all-wise, the all-knowing, the all-hearing. To him belong all creatures in the heavens and on earth. Everything belongs to Allah. All the creatures. Allah cannot be questioned for his acts. But we will be questioned for ours. Allah is the Al-Ghani, the self-sufficient. He needs no help from anyone, anything. He is Malik al-Mulk. He's the sovereign Lord. It is he who created the night and the day, and the sun and the moon, all the celestial bodies swim along each in its rounded course or its orbit. He's the Khaliq, the creator. So this is why that we give Allah respect. This is why we follow his commandments. This is why that we make sure that our duties to Almighty God Allah are prepared. We're prepared to perform our duties. We prepare to pray. We prepare to fast. We prepare to do the right thing. We prepare to be clean. We prepare to be knowledgeable. We just don't haphazardly, accidentally bump into these things. We prepare these things for our life. Because Allah is the one who gave us life. Nothing else, nobody else. And there's a warning in Surah 6, Ayah 51, the chapter called Al-Anam, or the cattle. And the word literally goes like this. Give this warning to those in whose hearts is the fear that they will be brought to judgment before their Lord. This is the warning. Except for him, they will have no protector nor intercessor, that they may guard against evil. The warning is, except for Allah, there is no protector. No one to intercede for us. And that those who believe will accept this warning, and it will help them so that they may guard against evil. It will help them guard against evil. This society wants everything to be lackadaisical, no discipline, self-expression. People are more concerned about self-expression than they are about self-preservation. So, the purpose of Muslims being together, whether we come together for Jummah, or come together going to the store, or going to the movie, whatever we do, we are to strengthen each other. Be a reminder for each other. Because we are one body. Separate entities, but yet one body. Striving to be pleasing in the sight of our Lord. Striving to be pleasing in the sight of Allah. So we have to be kind to one another. Be thoughtful of each other's situations. So then the issue came up, well, which one is right? Which one is right? So the way I was instructed was that Ramadan Mubarak is correct because it's mentioned in the Quran. So I looked it up, I said, okay, so we have, it's a blessed message. The Quran is a blessed message. It was sent down on a blessed night. It's a book bringing blessings. It was sent down unto you full of blessings. So, everything connected with the Quran and connected with the Night of Power is connected to the word blessings. Nowhere does it say Kareem. And then when you do an investigation, you find out that Kareem was a cultural thing that came over here from overseas. And, you know, they had, the people over there had adopted Kareem, and they just taught us Kareem, and we start saying Kareem. But when you go into the, when you dig down deep, really, the correct term is Ramadan Mubarak. Blessed Ramadan, the blessed month, where the blessed book that's full of blessings was sent down on a blessed night. So there is our proof, I'm not saying so much proof, but there's our reasoning. So you will hear people say Ramadan Kareem, and you'll hear people say Ramadan Mubarak. So what we're just laying out where the Mubarak comes from and why it is was chosen to be used originally. Now what happened during this month of Ramadan? That's the thing. What happened during the month of Ramadan? The month of Ramadan is the ninth month. And nine is significant in the number to signify birth. You know, humans give birth in 9 months. And we get a rebirth through the Quran during this ninth month of Ramadan. We get a rebirth. We get a rebirth or rejuvenation of our spirit. We distill the soul. It's just like the water cycle. It rains. The sun hits the water, evaporates the water up, and in that evaporation, it really distills the water, because all the gross matter stays down. That water vapor goes up, it forms a cloud. Allah sends the winds, blows the cloud to different barren areas, and the cloud gets saturated, and it rains. So this is what happens to our soul. For 11 months, we've been dealing in this muck and mire out here, trying to make it, trying to keep it straight, trying to keep ourselves upright. And Allah says, now it's time. Now it's time. We're going to regenerate you. It's just like when you have your car for a year, a couple of years, and the brake light comes on, transmission light comes on. Well, it just needs to be tuned up. That's what it needs to be tuned up. And, you know, some of us that are not that familiar with cars, we'll just keep driving the car. We'll be out of oil. Hoses would be popping on the car. You can't steer the car. You look under the car, when you pull out of your spot, it's all oil and leaked out. And we just keep driving on. Especially if you got a Toyota or a Honda, it'll just run forever. And so what we're doing is we're really, we become a hazard, a traffic hazard, a hazard to ourselves, a hazard to our family, all the people that we transport in the car. And it's the same thing with our life. We become a hazard to ourselves. We become overwhelmed and overburdened with the pressures of this world. And then we get used to it. And we say, oh, that's just how it is. But Allah says, no, it's not how it is. I've sent you my messenger, your prophet. I've sent you one that has upright character and left him as an example for us to follow. condition of our property, well, we're subject to let other people tell us what went on and what didn't go on. You know, you can get a lot of good books on Prophet Muhammad, not the thick books and blah, just a regular book on Prophet Muhammad. They'll break it down. That Prophet Muhammad, before he was Prophet Muhammad, was an upright man. He didn't know anything about Allah, the angel Jibril, Ramadan, five prayers, zakat, none of that. He was just obeying the best suggestions in his soul, in his spirit. Now, unfortunately, a lot of folks won't say that. They won't even mention that. You've got to have to dig for that. That our prophet, Muhammad ibn Abdullah, as a young man, he didn't hang out in the streets. He wasn't a wild man sexually. He wasn't trying to rap. He wasn't no thug. He wasn't no gangster. But all the fellas his age were. Because they call that part of the, that time zone and that part of the world Jahiliyyah, which means ignorance, the days of ignorance, the times of ignorance. And you look up the word Jahiliyyah, it means a wild jackass. That's where the mentality of the people were. And we don't have to look far to see that. All we got to do is look out the door and you see it. Especially amongst our people. Especially amongst our people. Wild jackasses. Now, you know, a jackass already got a problem being stubborn. You think about a wild one. He don't want to listen to nobody. Just do my thing. And I don't care what anybody else thinks. So, but Muhammad, the point is, Muhammad lived during that time. He belonged to a group that will go out and they see people in distress, they would help them. They will go out and see people that were being misused by predatory loaners, loan sharks, he would help them. He will go out and fight against racism, clanism, gang warfare, all these things. So, he was so regarded for his character that he had a nickname. And his nickname was El-Amin, the trustworthy one. This was before he was Muhammad the prophet. He was El-Amin. They see Muhammad say El-Amin. They know he was truthful. They know that if they pledged anything to him, left some of their valuables with him, and they went out of town, that they would be right there when they came back. And because of his character, one of the notable ladies in the city of Mecca, Lady Khadija, a prominent businesswoman, she had suitors from all around. Even the main devil, Abu Sufyan, suited, tried to court her. She turned them all down. She had solicited Muhammad to come work for her, and he would take her caravan to different places, come back. He was an astute businessman. Not only did he make money, but he was honest. Very, very honest. And wherever he went, the people liked him. And that gave him more opportunity to make more money for Lady Khadija. Lady Khadija was 15 years his senior. And she approached him for marriage. So just talking about Muhammad here, you know, why was he chosen to be Allah's prophet, to be Allah's messenger? He was chosen because he stood up in the time of ignorance when it wouldn't have been nothing for a young man to be out in the street playing every night and nobody would have said a thing. But he stood up in a time of ignorance and he obeyed the best urging within him to be a human being. He stood up on his own. He was an orphan, didn't have a mother or a father. They did die when he was young. So he had all of the excuses tell you that there was an army coming up that hill, what would you do? They said, oh, that was me. We would raise our army and go defend the town of Mecca. He said, now that I tell you that I'm a messenger of Allah and I receive revelation from Allah. That's when all hell broke loose. That's when all hell broke loose. Now his close friends, it was a different thing. His close friends accepted it. But the general public, why? Because they didn't want to stop doing what they was doing. And that's the case we see today. It takes a special person, especially a young man, special person, to get sick and tired of what's going on out there and want something better for themselves. It takes a special person. And then when Allah brings the message, they say, this is what I've been looking for. This is what I feel inside of me. And then when they relate the message, there are people like this, yes. Not only just because it's coming from you, because you have a stellar record, but this is what I want. Tired of bumping my head up against the wall out here. In the name of, I'm going to have a good time. You know what the young people say? I'm young. Let me live my life. I'm young. When I get older, maybe I'll join this thing. Let me do my thing. And don't realize that what you do today affects what happens to you tomorrow. Doesn't matter if you're young or old. That's just scientific facts. What you do today, what they say, every action has an equal and opposite reaction. What you do today will affect what happens to you tomorrow. In other words, there's no grace period. Okay, now you 15, 16, 17. Well, we'll wait until you 35 and then we'll consider you to start being serious about life. And parents tell their kids that. Go sow your wild oats. You'd be surprised what parents tell their kids. So Muhammad was a righteous man without knowing he was a righteous man before he was called to be the prophet. When he was called to be the prophet, I'm bringing all this out because a lot of times we'll see people that claim to be Muslim that have on a kufi, sandals, a robe, a turban, speaking Arabic every 55 minutes. Every time you see them, you know, and then they're so humble, they're so humble. And then we look at them as if they're the prophet. So we start following them around. Then you see them, you catch them in the wrong, and it's, oh man, I know that Muslim went to Bible like that. I'm going back out of here, man, to get high. Because of an example that somebody let them down. The point I'm trying to make is that Muhammad is the example. Muhammad is the example. Prophet Muhammad is our example. Messenger Muhammad, Ibn Abdullah, is our example. That's Allah's choice for us. So we are to follow that example. When we see people that let us down, we just point it out, say, brother, you're falling. Sister, you're falling. Get yourself back together and try to help them out. But don't use that as an excuse to abandon your own salvation. That's my point. So the Ramadan distills our spirit up away from the gross matter that we've been working with and dealing with for the whole year. It distills our spirit up and purifies it, just like the sun purifies that water. Then when it gets got enough mass to it, then we come back down and deal with the people. But we have our minds, and we can deal with the people now and not be affected. Because, you know, the people, they're going to come out with the big guns, the bazookas, the grenade launchers, everything to attack you. And you can withstand that. You don't get knocked out. You might rock back and forth, but you can stand it because you got your heart back. You got your feet standing solidly on the ground. You got your spirit back. Been praying every day, making your night prayers. And the most important thing we've been doing is reading the Word of God every day. It's what distills that spirit. So we have, our mind is the tapes in our sight.